this reading, I feel so good about myself.
Yeah!
I feel like a real Korean now.
Making kimchi from scratch.
It's really good.
Yeah?
This
did you good?
This is way better than cereal.
Way better than cereal?
Yeah.
From a 14-year-old, that's high praise.
But the fact that she's a murderer is like, oh, that's like a cool personality trait that you have there.
What would you know about
yeah.
that?
Yeah. Welcome back, everybody, to our wrap-up of Karitathon.
Yay.
I had my mole cut off. It's maybe cancer. I don't know. It was giving me headaches and doing weird stuff, so I had to cut off my mole. So Sylvia looks beautiful in a traditional hanbok, and I look a mess.
Oh, God.
I feel like this could be a look, though, like an e-girl look, because I'm, like, wounded.
You
know?
Should have just
it's like
that.
A lot of blush.
Yeah, you should have just put on some blush.
Like, random. Remember, wasn't there a time when, like, random band-aids, like Nelly,
yeah.
would wear a band-aid?
It was a look.
It was a look. This is a look. Karitathon was so much fun.
I loved every second of it.
It, like, gave purpose to my life again. So, all together, we read 8.5 books, although we had some overlaps, so we read 6 books total. Mm. And we didn't just cook one Korean recipe.
Oh, we made lots.
We cooked Korean food all week long.
All week.
Let's check on our soup. Ooh, yeah.
Wow. Ooh, that looks so good.
This is going to be the first time I have eaten pork in many years. But someone can't make something that smells that delicious in my house without me eating it.
It smells very
pungent.
Pungent, yes.
A rite of passage. You never made it with your mom?
No.
Because she used to make it though, right?
She used to make it, yeah, but no, I would watch her make it, but I never made it myself or hoped.
I believe in you. Oh, there you go. Excuse you.
And we even made our very own for the first time. Kimchi! From scratch.
It's so good.
It's really good. It's way better than store-bought kimchi.
It's so good. Everyone needs to make their own kimchi.
Yeah, and we made enough that we were able to gift it to our friends. So we're like mm-hmm. the kimchi fairy, mm-hmm. spreading love and kimchi all over Houston.
And I'm wearing a traditional style hanbok
mm-hmm.
today. It used to be my mom's. And she was a wee one.
It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. You look beautiful.
Thank you.
Yeah, we also had fun. Like digging some relics from your past out of the attic, which I'll drop those videos in at some point.
All right.
But we have found the hanbok in the attic with some old clothes of their dad's, and it's like 150 degrees up here or something. So we're gonna go back down and look at it.
Okay, so we are going through.
Oh, wow. That's bringing back some weird memories.
Ooh, it's smelly in here.
Yeah. I bet it's weird.
Look through that shit. For sure. Oh, here we go.
Yeah.
Yeah, it stinks. Ooh, this is such a pretty color. It's like a jacket.
Yeah. I think there's also what he wore.
Maybe this is what he wore. Actually.
Oh,
this
yeah.
Is what, this is
that's a man's.
Vest.
Yeah.
Cool.
Oh, look, there's my mom. Oh, really?
Oh, wow.
Very 80s.
Yes.
Very, very 80s.
She still has that vest.
Sylvia, that was a look. Look at that big sunflower. Look at Ike is so sassy here. That's my husband.
Yeah, look, we have matching triangle hair.
Yeah, you and your mom, same hair. Oh my God, so cute.
I was a cute kid.
Yeah.
Despite the triangle perm. So, the vegetarian, I really enjoyed it. It felt very much like a weird painting.
Mm.
I don't know. You know what I mean?
Like kind of surreal.
Yeah. You visited each part of the painting and it was like a different part of the story. You know, it deals a lot with mental illness, how it affects each family member so drastically.
Mm. I think what was really interesting to me was seeing how people respond to mental illness in a different culture too.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Her family reacts to her
Yeah, they don't take it very well.
Downward spiral.
No.
They're like the opposite of supportive.
Yeah, it's really bad. Yeah. But yeah, definitely give this a read. It's really short. I loved it.
It's like difficult, right?
It's difficult to get through, but I couldn't put it down. I thought it was great.
Yeah. So that's going to lead into, I read that a few years ago, and so my first book I read of Creed-a-thon was Human Axe. I would say it's the most powerful book that I've read over the course of Creed-a-thon. It really, like, messed me up. So it takes place during this student uprising, and it feels extremely timely because it was, like, the government sent in the army to crack down on protests, and they killed hundreds of people. The book kind of revolves around the death of... And this happens early on in the book, so it's not really a spoiler, but the death of, like, a teenage boy, a middle school boy.
Oh, my God.
Who was at the protest, and he was actually, like, tending to the dead bodies who had already been killed because he felt guilty for his friend who died. And
wow.
I think this was maybe the best book I've ever read on violence. Something I noticed about all these books, there's a lot of use of second person. Mm-hmm. And three of these books had second person viewpoints. Yeah. I wondered if that was something to do with the language or something in translation, or if it's a more common storytelling device in Korean.
I don't know. That's interesting. I didn't think about that.
This one had second person.
It's difficult to, like, get used to it.
Yeah.
At first, when you get, like, the 30 pages in, you're like, okay, I finally, like...
The vegetarian, too, use second. Yeah.
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 It takes a little bit to get used to, because not many American stories are told that way.
Obviously, as a country right now, we're wrestling with, like, state violence, police brutality. Confronting that right away with the first book I read in South Korea, it's kind of really depressing, because it's like, I guess this is the whole world. Like, it's everywhere.
It's just human nature.
So I went from that into this, which is YA, where the violence is very much, like, aesthetic. I kind of got whiplash from that, because, like, this book was so... took violence so seriously, and, like, a lot of times, like, young adult books, like, don't really. Like,
yeah, they don't even really, it's, like, in the background.
Yeah, but the fact that she's a murderer is, like, oh, that's, like, a cool personality trait that you have there. Maybe we should talk about Wicked Fox, though.
Yeah, let's do it.
You finished it most recently. You
okay,
start?
Wicked Fox. I love this book. It was really fun. It felt like a K-drama.
Yes.
But a really, 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 like, good one.
So the main character is a fox spirit,
a
girl.
A Gumiho,
yeah. Which is very similar to Kitsune, if you, like, in Japanese, which is like a fox girl. I was actually reading it while waiting for my pizza delivery, and the girl who brought me my pizza was like, is that about a kitsune? And I was like, oh my god, no, but it's about a Gumiho.
What? Yeah. That's cool. I liked the mom relationships. There were a few mom relationships in this book that were sort of troubled.
Yeah. Yeah, no one had a good, simple relationship with their family.
No, and I think that's a pretty common theme in Korea.
Typical mother-daughter relationship. How would you know about that, Sylvia?
I'm not a Gumiho, obviously, but I felt sort of connected to the character in that way, that she had a very... I guess you could say it was toxic, but it was...
It's pretty toxic.
Yeah, but it's like... I don't know, man.
It's complicated.
Yeah. It's a complicated relationship, and, like, that's definitely me.
I think the boy, I forget his name, that was three books ago now.
Jihoon?
Yeah, Jihoon. He had a more toxic relationship with his mom.
Yeah.
Because his mom had gone to start a second family and, like, pretended not to know that he existed. At least Myung's mom stuck around.
Yeah.
Like,
she was,
and took care of her.
She
in
was
her way.
A good mom in her own way.
Yeah.
She protected her.
But it's that thing of, like, I know what's best for you.
Mm-hmm. She didn't really have any choice.
What I really liked about the romance in this book was that the boy, I felt like the boy was really not a stereotypical YA dreamboat. Like, he felt very unique to me. He's last in his class. And I sort of love a love interest who's, like, last in his class.
Yeah.
Like, terrible at school. Because usually they're, like, hot and smart and cute and funny. And, like, he was kind of a mess, but he felt very, like, real and lovable to me and very, like, an individual.
Yeah, I kind of fell in love with him.
Yeah.
You know, and they just are so accepting of everyone, like Jihoon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they have so many issues in their own personal lives.
Yeah.
He felt very realistic.
Yeah.
So
yeah, it was a cute book.
Yeah.
Should we talk? I feel like we should talk about Silence of Bones last.
Okay.
Because I think we have different opinions on it.
Oh. So.
I'll talk briefly about The Incendiaries. So I read this one. It's by R.O. Kwon, who is a Korean-American writer. We follow each other on Twitter, and I've really loved her takes on Twitter for years, so I've always kind of, like, meant to read her book. And so it's about a cult, which I'm always a sucker for a cult story. He has just left Bible school when he comes to college, so he's, like, lost his religion. And she starts getting involved with this Christian cult while she's at school. So she's like falling into religion. So they're kind of like missing each other on their spiritual journeys. And I was actually really interested thinking about Christianity across a couple different of these texts. Like, this book took a pretty negative stance on Christianity, obviously, because it's like the cult. It's an extreme fundamentalist cult that they get wrapped up into. And the author in the afternote talks about how she was a self-described Jesus freak in high school and then lost her faith. And this was really like her book about that.
Interesting.
But then in Silence of Bones, it was like about Koreans being persecuted for Christianity during the Joseon era. And Please Look After Mom had like a really positive view of Christianity. It was like really thematically important at the end. It wasn't a big element, but you'll see when you get to the end. I don't want to spoil it for you.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It was just interesting seeing like the influence of Christianity and like how differently it was portrayed across the different books.
Yeah. You know, my mom was indoctrinated in Christianity in college when she was in Korea, because white missionaries would come give speeches at the college and convert Koreans from Buddhism to Christianity, and that's how she became a Christian.
And she told me once that one of the reasons she like set her mind on marrying an American man because she loved those Christian missionary guys that came to her in college.
They must have been really good looking.
Well, and she said that like she like, I guess the men in her life so far hadn't really treated her with a lot of respect, or she'd had bad experiences with men.
That makes sense. Yeah, her dad was a bastard.
Yeah, and she felt like the Christian missionary guys were, like, so respectful, and she just kind of got fixated on this idea of marrying an American guy, which did not work out great for her.
Sucks for her.
Round one was not great.
No.
This book was really beautifully written. I was reading, like, I thought it was a 5-star review. I gave it 5 stars on Goodreads. And then I was reading some of the reviews of it. It was a surprising number of, like, 3- and 2-star reviews by people saying, like, what even happens in this book? Like, there's no plot. Like, there's a plot. There's people falling into a cult, but it is very, like, atmospheric and sort of dreamy. And, like, I really liked it. Oh, also, another reason I think people don't like it is the main character is, I'm not going to spoiler it, but, like, is very flawed. And you're not supposed to see him as a hero, but I think the main character does some, like, fucked up things. And I think some people think that invalidates a book. And, like, it's not YA. Like, the main character's not supposed to be a role model. I like how they show that he's flawed in a very realistic way. That college guys behave.
Okay.
Trigger warning.
This is all coming together now.
Yeah. But yeah, I thought it was like very honest and beautiful and well done. Well done, R.O. Kwon.
Cool.
Okay. Please Look After Mom.
I started it last night. I got to page 52.
Yeah. What do you like about it so far?
I love how it's written. Mm-hmm. I think it's very eloquent and I really like it.
Something I love is like this book, I feel like I learned more about Korea, like Korean culture than any other book because it goes into detail about like daily life that goes into detail about like the chores that they did every day. Like, what are the chores mom's doing? And it's really pastoral. And what is the nature? And like, I don't know what to say. I don't want to spoil it for you. Yeah. So,
well, we can say this author is very well known in Korea. She's like a best-selling author.
Yeah.
And the protagonist in the book is an author.
The first protagonist. Yeah.
Well, I'm not that far into the book.
Yeah. So you just read
You know, it seems a little autobiographical.
Yeah. This book has, I think, 5 sections. So there's the first section is the one from the daughter who's like an author, which is that's number one. Then you get the perspective of the eldest son. Then you get the perspective of the father. Then you get the perspective of the mom who's missing. And then there's an afterword, which is back to the perspective of the
the author character.
Cool.
It's really interesting to see how, like, each member of a family understands their parent in such a different way. I'm like...
Yeah.
And then, but then we can never really know each other. It's one of those books about how we can never really know another person.
I mean, that's true.
Yeah.
You know?
Pretty true.
Well, I can't wait to finish it. I'm going to finish that today, probably.
All right. Last one. Let's talk about The Silence of Bones.
I just kind of cheated and just did it like this. I need to look it up.
That looks good. Looks right.
Okay.
Silence of Bones. All right, so you said this was your favorite.
I really liked it.
Okay, so tell me why it was your favorite.
I just thought it was just really interesting. I learned a lot about history that I didn't know.
Yes.
You know, conversion into Catholicism and, like, how they were persecuted, fucked up the monarchy is in Korea, or was. And I really liked the perspective of the servant. She was so smart, too. I loved how smart and, like, sharp she was.
Yeah. So it's like a mystery told from the perspective of this Damo, who's a servant of the police. A really engaging mystery. I didn't see it coming. Like, who? Usually
oh,
when
no,
I read mysteries,
I didn't.
I see it coming. I did not see it coming, who it was.
Me neither. I had no, I didn't know either.
Yeah.
I thought it was, well, what's his face the whole time?
Yeah.
I don't want to give it away, but.
Yeah. What's his face or what's his other face?
Yeah.
The ones that you were supposed to think, oh, it's probably that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I thought this book took violence a little more seriously than Wicked Fox.
Oh, yeah.
Which was good. Like, it kind of dealt with, like, the trauma and how it changes you, like, being around violence as she's, like, doing this police work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's my issue with the book, though, which is, like, the author, it's a thematic problem. So I think it was, like, a well-done mystery. I think the character, like you said, like, it was hard not to fall in love with that character. She was great. But she sent out to write a book about police massacring Catholics, right, for their religion. And she wrote it from the perspective of the police. That's my problem with it. And at the end, okay, this is going to be a spoiler because we both read it. But, like, at the end, she decides to go back and join the police because, like, girl boss. And it's like, I don't think it was really critical of the police. It's like, it ends up being like a one bad apple story where, like, there's this one police murderer. But at the same time, the author's telling you that the police, the next, like, a month later, they go out and, like, murder 1,000 Catholics or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And there wasn't, like, a bigger systemic criticism of, like, oh yeah, the Joseon police force were, like, all cops are bastards, like, especially the Joseon police force.
Mm-hmm.
And then the girl then ends up deciding to, like, rejoin the police force. So that bothered me on a thematic level.
Yeah, I definitely see that.
Yeah. Well, then we're so used to copaganda, you know?
That's true. I'm just now starting to rework my brain.
To be like, oh, this is copaganda, like...
Yeah, I myself am indoctrinated to the police and respect them.
Yeah.
Even though I don't anymore, but...
But part of your brain still does.
Yeah, exactly.
And because mysteries are so fun, and mystery is such, like, a huge genre, and usually mysteries are told from a cop perspective.
Right.
And from what we've learned from, like, getting more into, like, abolitionism is, like, one, cops, like, don't solve mysteries. So this is largely just a fictional trope.
I was thinking that, too, while reading, like, why are they investing so much into this?
Yeah.
When all they're gonna do is murder all the Catholics anyway.
Anyways, yeah. Yeah. The book internally, like, doesn't make sense. Exactly what you're saying. Like, cops don't really solve murder. So I feel like we should keep the mystery genre, like, as writers, and just get rid of cops. Like,
yes.
Because cops don't actually solve crimes.
I second that.
They come to your house and they say, oh, that happened to you. I'm sorry. Or they make fun of you or ask you what you were wearing. And then they give you a ticket.
Even in Joseon era.
Yeah.
Korea,
they don't fucking solve crimes.
They probably did that shit too.
But like you said, I mean, it was a good book and I got sucked into it. And it was only kind of at the end, like, really just the way the ending, like, didn't sit with me. And I was like, I don't like that she went back to help them murder people.
I think she was drawn because of her brother, though.
Yeah. The emotional heart of the story made sense as long as you didn't really think about the massacre behind it. Which is weird because the author kind of set out to educate you about the massacre. But in order to enjoy the story and root for the characters in the story, you have to sort of forget about the massacre.
Exactly.
So that was kind of weird to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. How was this experience overall for you? Just, like, delving into Korean culture for a week.
It makes you want to participate more on a regular basis, like more immersing myself in it more often.
Yeah.
I've always appreciated Korean culture and I love it, but I've never like really taken the time to just completely delve into it like I have this past week.
Yeah.
And it's been wonderful.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Yeah.
I feel connected to my Korean side.
Yay!
So it's cool.
Yeah.
Like making kimchi. Look at this.
We made this.
It's beautiful.
Mostly Sylvia made it.
Yeah.
Like, chop some radishes.
I love it so much. I don't know. Yeah.
Than the regular.
So it's been really great.
Yeah.
I've loved this experience.
I've loved it too. I loved like the deep dive. I want to thank Monica and Chloe for making this challenge. We had a really wonderful time. It was a cultural thing for our whole family. You know, we got. Your teenager is watching K-dramas with us and, like, learning about their Korean culture. The kids reading picture books about Korean culture. It's just, like, been really wonderful.
Yeah.
I really needed this challenge, like, just to be able to read 5 books in a week. I've been super, like, unproductive and struggling with depression since the pandemic started. Setting ourselves to a task. And I think you should feel really amazing about reading 3.5 books
I
in
do.
A week. Yeah.
Honestly, I've never read that many books in a week.
Yeah, I've never read 5 books in a week. Even in college, like, never have read this much. And so it was really important for me to, like, set a goal and follow through on it. And, like, to hold ourselves, like, each other accountable to it, too, was really good. It just felt really good to, like... try to do something and actually do it.
Yeah.
I hope I can somehow figure out how to channel that energy into writing now.
And, you know, it felt really productive, too. Like, all this reading, I feel so good about myself.
Yeah! And not just, like, reading and cooking.
And cooking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a great week.
Mm-hmm.
We had a great time. We didn't talk about the K-drama we watched at all. But we should.
Rookie Historian.
You have, like, maybe kimchi in your hair.
Oh, that makes sense.
Okay, so we watched Rookie Historian. It was the K-drama we watched. We watched about 3 episodes. And it was an era where they banned books. I don't know if this really happened. Seems like it realistically happened.
Probably.
They're afraid of the influence of the West, so the king bans any Western or Chinese. The West, to them, was also China, because that was... So they have banned all Chinese and, like, American and British books and burned them. And so the main characters are a guy who's the prince, not the crown prince, the, like, other prince.
Possibly the most beautiful man I've ever seen.
Feminine and delicate. He's always wearing peach-colored hanbok.
He's so beautiful.
And he is secretly a ladies' romance writer and writes under a female pseudonym. So it's him and then a very spunky young girl who works as a reader. So she professionally, like, gets paid to read books to illiterate noble women so they can enjoy sexy romances.
This show is so wonderful.
And it's really good so far. And
the costumes are beautiful.
Yes, and we're really enjoying it.
Love
it. Okay, thank you for watching. Thank you, Monica and Chloe, for creating Creed-a-thon. We had a really great time. It was wonderful for our whole family.
Yay.
Yay.
We did it. Creed-a-thon.
Join us for the next video. Subscribe and like and comment and tell us about what you read for Creed-a-thon if you did it.
Bye.
Bye.